Today's message is based upon Matthew 5, verse 5. Jesus is teaching through these eight, we call them Beatitudes. They're how to make a person content and be filled with the power of the Spirit and have joy in spite of circumstances or consequences of life. Overcoming the hurdles, and today is on Matthew 5, verse 5. Friedrich Nietzsche was a German philosopher, author, a poet, cultural critic, Latin and Greek scholar, even a composer of music. He frequently wrote on religion, morality, or let's say immorality, philosophy, and even human science. He was a brilliant man. He lived from 1844 to 1900. Now, most of you probably say, I don't know anything about Nietzsche, nor do I want to. Yeah, you do. Because you've seen shirts, t-shirts that says God is dead, and he coined that phrase. He really coined that phrase after reading and studying the Sermon on the Mount. His hatred and venom of Jesus Christ grew out of that sermon. He could not stand Jesus Christ. Much of what you learn about him in popular modern books is not true, or it's not the whole story. As Paul Harvey would say, you have to learn the rest of the story. Strokes seemingly took Nietzsche from this life to the next, but that's only half the story. The press of his day say that he had a stroke and died as a result, but the strokes were only a result of a lack of sleep and great psychological problems that Nietzsche dealt with most of his adult life. The psychological problems were brought on by a series of decisions that Nietzsche made in his life physically. He couldn't seemingly stop saying yes to the things that drove him. Often alcohol and other things would drive him to write deep things. And he said and wrote that he would go into trances and write. Then he kind of fell in love with many of his friends' wives and had adulterous affairs with them. And what you learn from a deeper study of Nietzsche is he contracted syphilis, which gave him all kinds of problems physically that he just couldn't seem to overcome. This great philosopher that you can read about in colleges and university is the one who said God is dead after studying the Sermon on the Mount and specifically the Beatitudes. And one in specific that he hated was Matthew 5, verse 5. He wrote these two phrases also. The teachings of Jesus are the most seductive lies in all the history of mankind, end of quote. And he also said this, Christianity is the religion of pity. Pity makes suffering contagious. Wow, he didn't like suffering, and yet think of the decisions he made in his life which resulted in worse sufferings than a Christian believer can have, because he made bad choices, poor choices. Nietzsche framed his criticism of Christ upon the basic teachings of Jesus in the Sermon on the Mount. And as I said, Matthew 5, verse 5, he looked at it and he just said, this is beyond reason, beyond rational thinking. People would, no one would ever say this because, of course, no one wishes to be meek. And in Nietzsche's day, there were a lot of meek men in our country. But he didn't like meekness. He didn't like meekness at all. He didn't like meekness around the globe. And so he wrote about this, and he believed Jesus to be, quote, a weak pacifist who allowed the world and the Romans to walk all over him, end of quote. But Jesus taught almost 2,000 years ago, blessed, content, happy, filled with joy are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Well, that caused Nietzsche all kinds of problems. Though many here this morning may never agree with Nietzsche's philosophical angst against Christ, you would have tendencies to agree with him concerning this issue of meekness. Because in today's age, the meek get trampled and run over, and the strong survive. We're taught not to be transparent, not to show ourselves as in any way, shape, or form weak, and meekness is often looked upon as weakness. Infomercials on television would have you to believe that if you'll take a one-day, $159 course, you can learn how to sell and buy land, property, houses, and real estate for a fraction of what they're worth and make millions becoming rich and powerful. And thousands upon thousands of people flock to these conferences because in the mindset of most Americans, rich and powerful is the opposite of the antithesis of meekness, which many foresee as weakness. So we follow these commercials, we follow these plans that will give us wealth, health, and happiness, richness, and power. Kevin Trudeau is the millionaire who began buying airtime in the new millennial, airing infomercials. You'll remember the weight loss cure book that he wrote and things they don't want us to know about concerning the government. Just two of many of his books and many of his 30 to 90 minute documentaries on television. For just $19.99, Kevin would send you his books to tell you how to lose weight, get rich quick, buy and sell property, or have common cure for ailments like arthritis or diseases like cancer that he claimed the government has allowed through the American Mental Association to just get away without telling us the cures. And people were buying these books. Notice on the front cover of all the books, they'll say, number one best-selling book in America. And there's a trick to getting your book to be the number one bestseller. And he used all the tricks, he used all the schemes. In just a short time, Kevin Trudeau became a multi-millionaire. In 2011, he was arrested for fraudulent claims and unsighted statistics and surveys that found his informational guides, booklets, and reports were just not true. In 2012, he was penalized and fined $37.6 million by the government, and it was upheld in the Seventh Court of Appeals. In 2013, Kevin hid his money and then claimed bankruptcy. On March 17th of 2014, Kevin began serving a 10-year term for fraud in federal prison. I guess crime doesn't pay. But infomercials do. He hid that money. So when he gets out in 2024, a lot of people are going to once again find Kevin Trudeau to be their friend. But the Bible says it this way, be sure your sin what? Will find you out. And we kind of don't believe that, do we? Because we allow our sins, which are just missing the mark, just a little bit, we allow our sins to exponentially grow and fester, or we leave them alone. We don't confess them as John told us we should in 1 John 1:9, and get rid of them and deal with them while they're sin instead of letting them go into iniquity and then into, of course, transgression. But I really, in looking at this beatitude, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. It's a difficult one to teach people today because most of us, we agree with the teaching, of course, but we have our own way of defining meekness and what Christ was. What is meekness? What did Christ mean when he said, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth? How can I become meek if I'm going to inherit the earth? Webster's dictionary defines meekness as a deficiency in courage. A deficiency in courage. Not something necessarily that most people want to be, deficient in the area of courage. But thank God that Webster's dictionary does not define the meekness that Jesus was talking about in Matthew 5. It doesn't at all. Because you'll learn something today about meekness that Jesus was teaching, and there are many characters in the Old and New Testament that exemplified the meekness of Christ. So if they can do it, you and I can do this. And we can be a meek person. But before I go on, you've got to get it in your head. There's nothing wrong with being meek. Even though Webster might define it as a deficiency in courage, and others say that it's gentle, easily imposed upon. One other definition said submissive or soft. And we don't like any of those terms. We want strength and power, control and authority. We want to be our own bosses. We like the commercials that tell us we can have it our own way, do it our own way, make our own decisions in life. We like, apparently in America, those politicians that say, you can do it my way, like Sinatra sang. We like that. That seems almost American, which is the antithesis of what Jesus was teaching the people of the Jews who were listening to him that day, thinking, dude, the first two, I thought you're just crazy. Now I know you need to be put into a home. You're nuts. You're off the funny farm to say, blessed, happy, content, joy-filled are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. The Romans are just beating us down. You've already let us know that if they ask us to walk 1 mile, we should walk the second mile because of our spirit. The letter of the law isn't enough. You want me to go beyond that. Why? They're mad at him. Well, now they just are shaking their heads saying, he's just nuts. He's just crazy. He doesn't get it. He's teaching things that are the antithesis. They're just psychologically, I can't accept this. But they are teachings that are both Old and New Testament. I want you to see something. Psalms 37, verse 11 was the quote that Jesus used when he was teaching Matthew 5:5. For in Psalm 37, David wrote, blessed are the meek. The meek shall inherit the earth, he said. Here, as it was in Matthew 5:5, the meek are defined in the original language as the oppressed ones. Did you get that? Jesus is saying, if you are a meek person, you're more than likely in this age going to be oppressed, burdened with the present age. Whether it's in the year 33 AD or it's in the year 2019. Jesus is saying, blessed, content, joy-filled are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now, let me stop right there and write this down in the margins of your Bible or on your notes today. Psalm chapter 24, verses 1 and 2. And it's on the overhead screen, but there the psalmist declared, the earth is the Lord and all its fullness thereof, the world and all those who dwell therein, for he has formed it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Think about something. If you take something and you make it today, you can give it to whoever you want. If it was your stuff and out of your stuff you took and made something, you can give it to whoever you want. The Lord called this earth into existence. Out of nothing, he made something. He fashioned and formed everything that he made in the first 6 days of creation. And after that, he taught us how to rest in him and in his Father, right? We all know and accept that. If he called it into existence, he made it, he fashioned it for us, he can give it to whomever he wants. It's his to give. It doesn't matter who's on the land or title deed the last time before Christ steps down on earth. When he comes again, he can give it to whomever he wants because it is his. He created it. Amen? Stay with me, y'all. So if he made it and it's his to give, he is saying to those disciples who follow him, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit this earth. If you follow eschatology, end times teaching, you learn that Christ is going to come a second time. 1/3 of the times that our Bible talk about Christ, it's about his first advent, when he first came. But 2/3 of the times in our Bible, Old and New Testament, when we're taught and told about Jesus Christ, it's talking about when he comes again and what he's going to do, the second advent. And I'm not talking about the rapture. The Lord does not step foot on this earth when he raptured the bride, the church. But he does step down on this earth when he comes for the second advent. When he comes the second time, the mountains will rend. Watch this. Remember, when he was crucified on that cross and gave it up, there was an earthquake and dead people were walking around the city. And things were shocking. And people couldn't explain what happened. That is what's going to happen from the very onset of when he steps down again. And the whole world will see him as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But watch this now. When he does that, he will slay the armies of the world who have risen up and raised themselves up against his children, the people of Israel. And then after that, there's going to be a 45-day period of cleanup. And then the Lord will set up his earthly kingdom out of the city of Jerusalem, his throne, once again, and there will be a 1,000-year reign of Christ. That's end times teaching. That's the Bible in a nutshell, really teaching us the end times. 1,000 years he will reign. And they say we're burning up earth. There's got to be at least 1,007 years between you and me and the end of that age. So take stock. You know, go and buy a bigger Suburban or SUV. You won't burn a hole in the ozone just by yourself. I am not advocating that we shouldn't in any way take care of the earth. The Lord gave, after he created the garden, he gave Adam the right to maintain it and to be a steward of it. And we're to be stewards of this earth, but what you're hearing in science books and out of science classes and from many scientists is not true, that we're just burning up the earth and it's not going to last 1,000 years. If you believe them, you'll have to discard the word of God. So the world is the Lord's and all therein, the people, the land, the animals, the homes, everything, and he is going to give it to the meek. So if you're a part of the meek, you will inherit the earth. However, you've got to define two things. First of all, you've got to define what is meekness according to the Lord Jesus Christ. And the second thing is, why don't we define meekness in the same way? So let me quickly go through these three points with you, if I may. First, three types of power here on earth. There is first the power that's out of control. Power that's out of control, because we all know power is where meekness is. That's the truth. But power out of control is not meekness. If you would, turn in your Bibles to Daniel chapter 4. Right after Ezekiel in our Old Testament is this awesome book of Daniel. So look with me there at Daniel chapter 4. In Daniel chapter 4, we have this dream of Nebuchadnezzar. He's the king of Babylon. Babylon back then was like America and Washington, D.C. now, only bigger and better. You might think that America is the most powerful nation on the face of the earth, and it is, but it wasn't the most powerful then. It considered Babylon to now, they ruled and reigned. If you remember in the book of Daniel, the statue that was made, the head was made of gold, and that symbolized Babylon. And Nebuchadnezzar was the king of Babylon. And in Daniel chapter 4, verses 28 to 33, look with me there and allow me, if I may, to read these verses to you. All this came upon King Nebuchadnezzar. At the end of the 12 months, he was walking about the royal palace of Babylon. The king spoke, saying, "Is not this great Babylon that I have built for a royal dwelling by my mighty power and for the honor of my majesty?" While the word was still in the king's mouth, a voice fell from heaven. "King Nebuchadnezzar, to you it is spoken, the kingdom has departed from you." See, he had this dream, and he saw this beautiful tree in this dream. And he called Daniel into the palace, and he said, "Can you explain this dream, this tree that I saw, and then it was cut off?" It's a puzzling, perplexing dream. And Daniel asked the Lord to give him wisdom to know how to interpret the dream to the king. So then he went back to the king, and just as Daniel had told him, it happened. King, he said, "Don't let these things, y'all," he said, "don't let these things happen. Humble yourself. My God, the God of Israel, has created all of the world and all of the inhabitants, and he has made you the leader of it right now. Your kingdom reigns, and he has raised you up to reign and rule in this. This is not of you. Don't allow your pride to insulate you and make you feel like you are self-sufficient. Because if you don't, the tree that you saw in your dream is you, and you will be cut down. And for 7 years, you will live like a beast, like an ox out in the field. The king laughed and scoffed at Daniel. A year later, he's in the king, he's in the palace, he's looking out over his kingdom and over the city of Babylon, which was drop dead gorgeous. The seven wonders of the world talk about this city. Two things: the rivers that they had flowing through there, the aqueducts, brought cold water, and then they had hot springs that they had devised and developed. We don't know how they did it. And then they had hanging gardens. More than likely, Nebuchadnezzar was looking out on these hanging gardens from his window, saying, look what I have built. Look at this kingdom. Look at this city. And I have done it, and I've done it for me. Man, I am the man. He was power out of control. And just as Daniel had told him, the dream was the interpretation of the dream. Nebuchadnezzar was cut off, and his kingdom was taken away from him. And he lived with a psychological disorder where he thought of himself as a beast. He let his hair and his nails grow long. He roared like an ox, and he allowed his beard to go Duck Dynasty times, you know, steroids. It was crazy. The guy, people would say, that was Nebuchadnezzar. Back in the day, he was the man. I mean, he was the stud, not just of our kingdom, but he led the world. It'd be like our president going crazy, not just a Trump or an Obama or a Bush, but it would be like watching any one of our presidents lose his or her mind and going psychologically crazy, and the whole world would look in and say, ah, that's too bad. The fella had it all going, and then he lost it all. And he's extremely nuts. That's power out of control. Nebuchadnezzar had all the power of the world, but it wasn't enough. Now, watch this. It says in Ezekiel chapter 28 that Lucifer was created God's highest anointed cherub in heaven. He had a covering on him that was beautiful. His pipes and trim timbrels, the writer there says, was made and fashioned by God to lead worship in heaven. And boy, was he good. He was not good. He was awesome. He was great. All of heaven would sing the majesty and the power of God. And every angel and created being would worship God. And Lucifer was the leader of that. Son of the morning was his name. But something happened in Lucifer's heart. And in Isaiah 14, 12 through 14, Isaiah documents what happened in Lucifer's heart. God looked out and saw in his heart. He didn't hear Lucifer saying this to the other angels. He saw in Lucifer's heart, Lucifer saying five things. I will be like God. I will ascend into the mountain of God. I am just as powerful. I am just as wise. I am just as all-knowing as God. And I will ascend into his throne and the mount of God. And so for that reason, Revelation chapter 12 tells us that God took that dragon, Lucifer, and cast him out of heaven and cast him to the ground. And one third of the angelic host fell with Lucifer. That is crazy. Did you know, according to the book of Jude, that small little letter, there are some demons who fell that have been reserved in chains forever. Others, one verse in our Bible tells us that some angels were obliterated, annihilated. That day when they tried to devise a plan against the coming Messiah, God just said, enough, they're done. And God can do that because, well, God's God. But Lucifer was God's highest anointed cherub. He was in power in heaven to praise the greatness and the glory and the grandeur of God. But it wasn't enough. Why? Because power was out of control in Lucifer's life and in his heart. So he was cast out of heaven and cast to the ground. If it can happen to Lucifer in heaven and it can happen to a king on earth, don't think that it couldn't happen to a prince of a guy like you. You can be a frog. And your wife's saying, well, I kissed you and made you back into a prince again. Maybe. Let's go to the next point before we delve into that. Power out of control, Lucifer or Nebuchadnezzar. And then there's a second power that's discussed in the Bible that's not a definition of meekness. There's power in control. And I don't have time, but I'm going to tell you. 1 Samuel chapter 9, verses 1 and 2, and verse 17. The people of Israel come to God. And they are saying to God, we want to be like all the other people on earth. And God's like, I know you. I know. They're like, no, no, no. What we're saying is we want a king like all the other countries do. We want a human manifestation of someone who's in charge so that we can be like other people. And God said, you have a king. I'm your king. And I'm honored to be your king. And as long as you follow my mandates, my statutes, my commandments, I'm going to bless you. And if you walk away, I'm going to... And they knew this. They all knew the Shema. But they said, but King God, give us an earthly manifestation. Give us a man. God knew their hearts. Now, here's the thing. God could have, because he's God, he could have just said, I'm your king. You have no say in this. No. But God knows your heart, and he knows my heart. And he gives us what's called the free moral agency of mankind. He knew they were going to do it anyway. So God sent Samuel out, and Samuel went into the least tribe and to the least clan of the least tribe, and he saw this man who was really tall and a very good-looking man. And God said, Samuel, that's the one. The people of Israel want him. They want him. And we're going to anoint him. He's going to be their king. So Saul came and he was put, listen, in power. He had the power. Verse 17 of that chapter tells us King Saul had power in Israel. And God's stamp of approval was on him until King Saul said, I'm in power. I'm in control here. And when you and I say, I'm in control, I want power. Now let me give you a quick little infomercial of that. Some people in church life, some people in government, they go behind the scenes and they do lots of things that we never get reports on, we never find out on television, like those men who went in and killed Osama bin Laden. We know there's troops who go secretly undercover and they do things and we never have acknowledged them because of the fact they are secret service people. They are commandos who are trained to go in undercover. They're under the scene. They're undercurrent kind of people. They have great power, but they never talk about it. King Saul was that kind of a king. God put him in a place to be in power so that the people could be like the other people and God could rule the kingdom through Saul. But he even, listen, he even was anointed like you would a priest. But then he found himself in power, you know what I mean? In control. And that's where things spun out of control. Because God doesn't put you in the pilot seat and say, fly this plane. No, 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 no. He puts you in the pilot seat and expects you to let him be the pilot. And he calls out the commands and you obey. It's like a coach on the sideline who's got a prompter in the helmet of the quarterback. The coach is calling the plays. All the quarterback does is huddle the team up and say, this is where we're going. This is what the coach has said. This is the next play. No, no, no. King Saul wanted the power, and he wanted to be in control. So he took things away from God and said, I do a pretty good job here on my own. And God just said, man, my anointing is off of him. In Daniel chapter 2, if you would just go back two pages and look with me, two verses in Daniel chapter 2, which defines power in control. Daniel, in talking to Nebuchadnezzar, this is what Daniel said. Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are his. He changes the time and the seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise, knowledge to those who have understanding. It's God orchestrating your life. You may play the keyboard. You may be the guitarist. You may be a flautist. You could be a sax player. You could be the drummer, but you're just playing. God is the great conductor of life, period. All things by his sovereignty happen and occur. He either gives them by permission and allowance, or he just says, my perfect will is going to happen because you have submitted yourself and you're centrally right in the midst of my plan. Whether you get out and do it on your own like King Saul, and you may think, now I'm in control. Or you do it like David did when David came in to rule. You do it God's way. Though you may have the position, God should receive the praise. Watch this now. Lots of people today want a title. Instead of being like a Navy SEAL doing things for God under his control, and under the current, under the covers, under so that people don't pronounce you and see you on the platform. You don't need a title to serve in the place and the position to do the duties and the functions. There's lots of people that seek after the title like it's something that other people really would acknowledge or admonish in your life. And that's what King Saul did. He was power in control, but he was out of control. Then there's the third that Christ talks about. That's power under control. Matthew 5, verse 5. Blessed, happy, content, joy-filled are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. So one day, God's going to grant the inheritance of all that he's ever called into existence to the Lord Jesus Christ, his son, because he humbled himself on the cross, even to the point of death. So God's going to turn over the inheritance to his son. And what happens next is mind-blowing. The son is going to share his inheritance with the meek. Now, that may be 5 years off. That could be 50 years off. That could be another 5,000 or million years. I don't know. We don't know when the Lord will rapture his church and we will receive our rewards at the Bema. We don't know that. But one day, it's coming. Watch this now. If you're living for the here and now, it's like having a bucket up here of water. And I've heard some pastors and other people say, well, if you're living for the here and now, it's like a bucket of water, a drop, just being dropped into the bucket. And I think, no, that's not exactly what Christ is promising in the Beatitudes. He is talking about kingdom things, and kingdom things are eternal things. That bucket represents like an ocean. So you could take that bucket and throw it into the ocean, and you might live 80, 90, 100 years and be in power here on earth. But if you're under the power of the Holy Spirit of God, it's like taking that bucket and taking the oceans of mankind, all that we have here on earth, and throwing it out into space. Because eternity, listen, y'all, eternity is eternity. We can't even with our finite minds understand and estimate how long eternity. Think of that. You might have power here on earth for 80, 90, 100 years, but that's going to be not a drop in the bucket. That's going to be like an ocean compared to the eternity of time that you and I will have to inherit the earth. So who wants a big inheritance? Who wants a big inheritance? Power under control. Listen to me. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 29, go with me there. Matthew 11, verse 29. Jesus said, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. When your power out of control, it's like Nebuchadnezzar. You can't rest at night because, well, you got to have more power. There's never enough. And it'll drive you mad. And worse, it drives you even out of heaven, like Lucifer. And if you have power in control, like Saul, you might experience power for a short interval or temporal time, but it's not eternal. And you'll lose your place, because being in control as a person, human being, makes you out of control being of the Spirit of God. So if your power under control, Jesus said, I am meek, lowly of heart, humble. Take my yoke upon you. Then he says in Matthew 21, verse 5, this is what was said about him. Tell the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, but really, it's a colt, the foal of a donkey. This is an Old Testament passage that was taken right out of Isaiah, a prophetical utterance from Isaiah and Zechariah saying, when the Lord comes, the Messiah comes, he's going to come into Jerusalem on a colt, lowly in heart. I've got a few last things to say, and it'll sum everything up for you so you can see it. I want to be meek, but I'm not perfect like Christ. And he was God. And you think to yourself, God can do this, Christ can do it, but I can't do that. Well, there's other people in our Bible that we're told, even in the Old Testament, who were meek people. First is Abraham. After God called Abram from Ur of Chaldean to the Promised Land, a dispute arose amongst his family. A guy by the name of Lot wanted his lot in life. So Abraham was so under the control of God at this point of his life that he looked at Lot and he said, you and I just can't agree. We're just not going to be able to coexist. So why don't you, God has given me all of this. Why don't you pick what you want? And of course, Lot chose the cities and the best land, and he gave Abraham the leftovers. Guess what God did? Lot went and had to be rescued from the cities and the best of the land. And God blessed Abraham with the worst of the land. God's blessing just came all over Abraham. And you know the reason why? Because he was power under control, which is truly the biblical definition of meekness. And then you have this guy Joseph, who was thrown into a pit and left to die, only to later be sold into slavery by his own brothers. Their contempt and hatred and jealousy of him was fierce. They tasted the death of Joseph. They so hated this young man. His father's best was given to Joseph, which made them hate him all the more. That jacket represented all that they hated about that youngest son. They just wanted to be rid of him. Some of them just wanted to kill him. So they put him in a little pit to save, and one of the elder ones said, let's just sell him and make some money off of daddy's favorite. So they did. The dreams of Joseph were now full turn, as Joseph has gone from pit into Potiphar's house, into prison, and in one day, because he was power under control, God elevated him to the palace. But that wasn't the greatest place that Joseph would ever be. The greatest place that Joseph was ever be, when he was mature enough, complete enough in his faith, he's standing over his brothers as they're mourning their father's death. And they're all bowed down to him. And they're thinking, he's going to get us. He's going to get us because he's got the power, and we don't. And he owns it all. Man, he's going to do it now. And he's like, brothers, brothers, you meant this for evil against me, but God has meant this for good. Power under control, meekness. God had elevated Joseph to that place, not just for Joseph, not just for Joseph's brothers and his father and his family. God had elevated Joseph to that place for the people of God to be saved and for a remnant to come where they would be safe. That was Joseph, power under control. That's meekness. And then there's this third David we have in the Bible. And then we have a fourth. We have Moses in our Bible. And man, Moses is a tough one. A careful study of this man could lead the casual Bible reader to say it was a mistake to say that Joseph was, or Moses was meek. He hastily killed at the age of 40 an Egyptian soldier while defending a Hebrew worker. Isn't this the guy who came down from the mountain of God and found the children of Israel having a toga party? And he said to them, I can't believe what you're doing. And he took the tablets and he broke them, having a temper tantrum. Is this the guy that you really say, Pastor, who's meek? Well, is this the guy who's also meek? Isn't this the guy who had a temper tantrum and struck the rock instead of speaking to it? Isn't this the guy who went to Pharaoh and said, let my people go? Is that meekness under control? No, he hadn't got to that place yet. But God took him at the one-third point of his life, and God said, now Moses, you've done it your way. Now you're going to learn how to do it my way. And for 40 years, he put him through the school of hard knocks so that Moses would be ready for God's people. So Moses, for 40 years, after he had a kind of a conversation with a bush that was on fire, that wouldn't be consumed, he recognized the great I am was in that bush, and he had to humble himself to that. And so he humbly went before Pharaoh and said, God said, you're going to let his people go. Now watch this. It is said about Moses that he was the meekest. The King James Version has it right. It says he was the meekest man on all the earth at that time. And when you get to Numbers chapter 12, you got to see this, y'all. Numbers chapter 12, verse 3. Moses comes down and into the camp of Israel one day. Now, they'd been murmuring and complaining about him for years. At this point, honestly, they hated the guy's guts. They had prayed for over 400 years and many generations for God to give them a Moses. And when God finally said, here's Mo, complain no more. They just kept on because it was a part of their character. So they grumbled about him every day. They said, we're hungry. Moses prayed, God gave them quail and manna, meat and bread. And they said, that's all he can do? We're thirsty. Moses prayed and God gave them water out of a rock, fresh, cold water. The best water, not like they say in all the beer commercials that it comes out of the mountains and all. I mean good, cold water. And man, everything that they had complaints about, they complained about the fire that led them at night. They complained about the cloud that covered them by day. They were a complaining type of people. So after he's put up with all of this, you would think he'd have his brother and his sister to come home to and say, and he's lost his first wife, y'all know that, right? He lost his first wife. So he wants to come home to Miriam and his brother Aaron, who's a priest. And he wants some common threads with it. He comes to home and he overhears them. And even more so, it says in Numbers 12, verse 3, God heard Miriam and Aaron gossiping about their brother. Can you imagine being rejected by millions of people for 40 some years? And you come into the camp to the people that you love the most, and they're supposed to love you, and you hear your brother and sister talking not just about you, but against your wife, because his new bride was an Ethiopian girl, Cushite more than likely, dark skin, and they didn't really like her. Oh, Moses thinks that God talks to him, but he talks to us too. And when God heard it, the Bible says God heard it, Moses still was filled with meekness in that he was power under control. He didn't lose it at that point like most of us would because he was meek. And there's just one other. And you know that man. Jesus Christ. The Jews were looking for a Messiah to come and establish his kingdom on earth and rescue them from crazy terrorists like the Romans. Still looking. They were looking for a king who would bring judgment upon those terrifying, tyrannical leaders. They were looking for a powerful, mighty, almost magical man who ruled and reigned with a power unseen that the world had never witnessed before. Jesus is standing before them, and he's now teaching and testifying as the most powerful teacher of his day that meekness, power under control, is what they need to be. And that if they're meek, they will inherit God's earth. Wow, they just didn't get it. He's teaching submission to authorities, paying taxes to the rule of the Romans, becoming a people who serve others, and others who even demand slavery of them. This is his teaching. This was the opposite of what they were working, looking, and wanting to receive. So they rejected his teaching. They rejected his man, his person. 3.5 years later, this same teacher is being smitten, beaten, shackled, spat upon, struck. His face was unrecognizable. He's beaten half to death, bloody, beaten, and completely broken. They fastened him like a burden to a tree and hoisted him up and mocked him and gambled over his clothes at the foot of that cross. And there, with his open arms, he is still filled with power and meekness, strength under control. And he's saying and whispering to his Father, "Forgive them, for they know not what they do." And you know why Christ is teaching this about meekness? Because it's said in John chapter 3, verse 14, "As Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up." He did that. He did that and came under the power and the control of the Holy Spirit of God for you and for me. That's power under control. I'm certain you've heard the story about the rich, wealthy landowner had this huge mansion. Only had one child, then his wife died. His one son was in the military and on a mission. His son lost his life. The most prized possession that rich landowner had was a picture, a portrait of his son that he hung over his chimney, over his mantle on his chimney. He loved that. Every day as he went out to work, he would look at his son. Then the old man died, and they were auctioning off all of his estate. He had just one rule for the attorney who had an auctioneer. The one rule was that day as the auction began, the portrait of the son would be the first item to be auctioned. So the auctioneer stepped to the mic. He said, "This is the first. This is the one. It's the only portrait of this son. This was the prized possession of this rich man. Who will put in a bid? Hundreds, thousands of dollars." The auctioneer thought the portrait would bring, but no one made one bid. And the auctioneer kept going lower, 100, 50, 10. There was one little old maid who had served that old man for many, many, many years. She too loved the son, but she was broke. All she had was a 10 spot in her purse. She held up the $10 bill. "I have a 10. So the auctioneer said $10. No one else had a bid. So the lady came and she claimed her portrait, and she was carrying the frame out when the auctioneer laid down the gavel and said, "Mr. Attorney, we finished." The attorney closed up shop. People were like, "Hold on, how about all these other possessions, the mansion, the house, all the cars, everything else?" He's like, "Oh, that goes along with the one rule. The one who got the son gets it all." You and I are possessors of the Son. He who has the life, he who has the Son has life. And he or she who does not have the Son does not have life. "These things I have written unto you that you may know that you have eternal life." And eternal life's not just enough. Will you inherit the earth? Will you become a possessor of that which God the Father has given to God the Son? And he's going to share his inheritance with all of us. Do you have that? If not, today, get your power under control, under the power and the control of the Holy Spirit. Oh God, we